episode 29 of The School Muscle with Valentin Tambosi. This guy is a natural pro bodybuilder. He's a prep coach. He really has a good understanding of the science and with a lot of practical experience to back it up. So I hope you enjoy this episode. So the first topic that I'd kind of like to talk with you here, Valentin, is avoiding the hard stuff. And you made a post kind of relatively recently about like pull downs versus barbell rows and how some people tend to kind of avoid just doing the hard things in the gym. So would you kind of like to speak on that and any examples you might have of avoiding the hard stuff?
Absolutely, man. So with that post, I just wanted to emphasize that nowadays there's so much information out there and so many different exercises, and we have so many people speaking on topics in the fitness industry that we have to be very careful who, first of all, who we listen to, and second of all, what kind of information we pick out. So when I made that post, I was thinking about people like trying to put everything on paper and making like comparing exercises. And 10 sets of pull downs will generate a completely different stimulus than 10 sets of rows, if we're talking like free weight rows. So the type of stimulus you create with a free weight row is going to be tremendously different from a pull down. Obviously, we have different muscles that are being worked, but I think we can also all agree on that a free weight row is much harder to do than a pull down. First of all, the pull down, you're sitting. It's a seated exercise, right? Number one. Second of all, there's not a whole lot of stabilization going on with a pull down. So with a row, if you like really pushing it, you are forced to work very hard. And I see people like saying, hey, I did like 10 sets of back today or 20 sets of back. And then you look at the workout in detail, and it's like five sets of a machine here, five sets of pull downs here, five sets of pullovers here. And while that is all fine and well, I think people tend to shy away from the basics, and the basics will, there's a reason they're called the basics, and you should have them in your program to a reasonable degree. And all the greats have built their physiques with pretty heavy stuff, and that usually involves doing the basics, and rows are part of that. So that was the reason I did that post.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And I know in my own training, like even when I consider like doing some isolation exercises, like a single arm tricep pushdown, like I feel that really well in my triceps. But man, I feel like I overload my triceps on a per set basis so much more, like doing a overhead dumbbell skull crusher or something like that. So do you have any like other examples of maybe some other exercises, or it could even be like, I know there's some controversy on deadlifts, not deadlifting and things like that. So is there any other examples of doing the hard stuff like that that you can think about?
Oh yeah. I mean, you just mentioned triceps. One thing that comes to mind is dips. Dips are usually exercises that are quite often pretty butchered. When you look at gyms, people are doing a weird, weird dipping motion, and it's not really full range of motion for their mechanics. So, I would put dips in there. And I mean, there's so many arm exercises that people can do instead of dips that are much more convenient. You like walk up to the cable station, just do a few pushdowns. You use different attachments and say, oh my God, this one hits the lateral head more and this hits the long head more. But the people that have big arms usually dip a whole lot. So when you break it down like that, it sounds very, very simple. And it is very simple. It's just not easy to do over time. I mean, seeing somebody like dip 200 pounds when they weigh 200 pounds themselves, that will result in some stimulus, right? And if you're like using the whole stack on a cable pushdown, that will result in some stimulus as well, but it's most likely not going to give you the same results as somebody dipping that amount of weight. So I'm not trying to like get people away from isolation exercises. But if you include an isolation exercise in your training program, make sure it really has its place, and that isolation exercise serves a purpose that a basic compound movement is not giving you. So if I can do it with a compound movement, I would tend to use that compound movement instead of an isolation exercise, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. So you kind of view isolation exercises more so as filling the gaps where your compound movements quite can't cover. Does that sound about right?
Yes, exactly. Or if I want to attack a weak muscle group and add some additional volume, I might add in some more isolation exercises for that particular muscle group. But if you just like bombard a muscle group with different isolation exercises, which could be done with one or two compound movements, you're just wasting your time. And you're just spinning in circles doing a ton of different exercises, but you are not overloading the muscle to the same degree as you would with basic compound movements.
For sure. I think that makes a lot of sense. And kind of along the lines of isolation exercises and things like that, do any exercises come to mind to you anyways that people might just kind of mess up? I know you've had a post in the past about kind of calf raises, and you had some really good tips on that. So would you kind of like to speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, calf raises, you can walk in any gym anywhere in the world and you will see some guys do some weird stuff on the standing calf raise machine or seated calf raise machine. So usually what I see with that exercise is not so much range of motion, that is also part of that gets messed up, but it's usually how people distribute force across their foot. So with a standing or seated calf raise, whatever it is, we want to distribute force across the ball of our big toe, and we really want to collapse our foot inwards. And if we do that, that's basically a pronation. And when we do that pronation, we are really loading the gastrocnemius, and we are not doing that if we roll outwards. So if we're doing a calf raise like this, it's much more like this is our big toe. It's much more likely we are actually loading the calf. But if we're rolling outwards like this on our small toe, we are not going to distribute force across that muscle, and we are just moving weight around. It's, of course, it's also much easier doing it like that, and that's why people do it. So you should get like a cramp-like contraction if you do it like that and distribute force across the ball of your big toe. And if you get that with every rep, you will realize that you've been training your calves wrong for a long, long time.
I know I had that experience with myself to where I read your post. I was like, damn, I haven't been doing that. I go to the gym. I do like one set of calves. My calves were cramping up. I was walking like I was like wearing high heels. Like it was terrible.
But exactly.
Yeah, it was great. And is there any other exercises or variations that you see kind of across the board that people might struggle a little bit more with for certain muscle group or something like that?
I mean, I'm really passionate about laterals, lateral raises. I mean, I think people by now know that, and it's something I really harp on because I think it's one of the most important exercises for a bodybuilder. And if you're interested in like an aesthetic appearance, you want to have wide shoulders. And while you can do overhead presses, you can do different variations of that lift. I think the lateral raise gives you the most bang for your buck for your lateral head. So I think that is an exercise you have to have in your training program and perform correctly if you wanna be in the hypertrophy realm and train like a bodybuilder. So what I see with that exercise is usually people don't internally rotate enough at the shoulder. So I see people like swinging their wrists higher than their elbows. And what I tell clients is lead with your elbows and don't think up and down, think in and out. So we want to imagine like two walls that are next to us and we shove them to the side with our arms, leading with our elbows. And if you do that, you will notice you have to use less weight. And second of all, the weight and the force you create is really with your lateral delt or with your entire delt instead of like your arm muscles or with your lower back because you're swinging that much, et cetera, et cetera. So I think the in and out cue is the most important one with the lateral raise and really, really approaching the lift like that instead of thinking up and down. I would use the same cue for a row. Instead of going up and down, I go forth and back. I pull back to my hips instead of up. And that makes a huge difference with the line of pull and how I hit the targeted muscle groups.
Cool. I think that makes a lot of sense. And on the topic of kind of lateral raise and rows, there's kind of a couple different camps to where, you know, some people think form should be strict, no swaying. It should just be front and back, perfect technique. Well, perfect. And then some people will go the other way and say, you know, a little bit of swaying might allow you to overload the muscle a little bit more, and it could be potentially beneficial. So where do you kind of fall along that spectrum?
I'm definitely in the camp of people that would recommend you like using looser form. If you are able to stay injury free that way. So we want to use a form that allows us to overload the muscle. And if we think about cheat reps or loose form in terms like that, it's nothing else than a load drop. If you think about it like that, it's an intensity technique because incorporating different joints and swinging with your hips and incorporating your hips into a lateral raise allows you to still overload the muscle at the top because you're swinging it into that position. If you would not use your hips, the set would be pretty much over, or you would just do partial reps in the bottom third range of motion. So in order to still get to the top point, to the end contraction, using different joints and incorporating different other muscle groups, you are still generating a stimulus, but it's just, you're just helping the muscle fibers out that are already fatigued from the target muscle group, if that makes sense. So when people say, oh my God, you're cheating, you're not really cheating. You're just exposing the remaining muscle fibers that haven't been fatigued yet with the help of other muscle fibers. And if you're doing it in a safe manner, I think it's a very smart technique, but I would only recommend it to advanced trainees. I would never ever tell a beginner to like start do cheat reps on lateral raise, on a curl, or whatever. And I would also say that on exercises that load the spine, I would be very careful with that approach. Let's say you can't really do a whole lot of cheating on squats. It's going to be a good morning or something, and that's going to be a completely different muscle group. You're like taxing more your lower back, your glutes, maybe even your hamstrings. So I would not recommend doing that. But if we're talking, funnily enough, isolation exercises, it makes a lot more sense. So curls, lateral raises, stuff like that, I would recommend cheating if you know how to do it safely.
Gotcha. So basically, in the context of maybe a little bit more advanced trainee, and in the context of you're doing it on an exercise to where it's still generally pretty safe, it's not like a big compound squat or something like that, then a little bit of partial reps to kind of overload the muscle a little bit more tends to make quite a bit of sense to you.
Absolutely. We really have to look at specific and individual exercises because if we look like an RDL, a deadlift, whatever loads the spine heavily, cheating is not recommended at all, right? It's just too dangerous. Right. But if we're talking smaller joint movements, I would definitely see a purpose there. And if you know how to do it, it's basically an intensity technique. It makes your training more intense. It allows you to tax all the muscle fibers that you can hit with that particular exercise. And I would definitely incorporate it in my training.
Cool. Yeah, I definitely agree with you there. And I don't see a problem with that for sure. And I think that the argument against this would be, well, why wouldn't you just do more sets with perfect technique and slow it down and do things like that? So what would you kind of say to that argument of just kind of either reducing the load and doing more sets and keeping technique in versus kind of doing these more intensity techniques?
Well, if you're training at an advanced level, sooner or later time is going to be an issue. So nowadays my training sessions last around 3 to 4 hours, and I already incorporate techniques like that. If I would not do that, I would have to do even more sets, and that would mean even longer training sessions. I have some friends that do 2-a-day sessions with the training. So they train in the morning and they come back in the afternoon and train again. That would mean longer training sessions for them as well. So these techniques can save time and increase training density. And I think training density is something that for advanced training is a very useful tool and can and should be used. And like I said, you cannot use these techniques. You cannot cheat reps on every single exercise, but on the few you can, I would definitely do it just to save time. And I mean, the argument to do more sets instead and keep everything picture perfect clean is a valid argument. But then again, usually when I talk to people that have been training for a long time, they will say, okay, I just don't have time to do that many more sets because I'm already I'm limiting myself with how much I put into my workout and how much time I spent there.
Yeah, especially when you consider that most people aren't really getting paid for this. So it's not like this is their full-time job. So like you probably have other things going on that you have to do. So increasing that density in favor of maybe doing just more sets probably makes a lot of sense. And you mentioned their 2-day training. Have you ever played around with that yourself personally and tried that out, or what do you kind of think on that?
Yeah, of course I did. And it is something that sounds very intriguing at first. And you're like, oh my God, this sounds pretty amazing. I'm doing like chest in the morning and I'm doing arms in the afternoon. That's perfect. And like after a week, you're like, okay, this is cool. After 2 weeks, you're like, okay, this is tough. After 3 weeks, you're like, this is becoming a real drag. I have to go to the gym twice a day. And the sessions are tough because you're fresh for every single session, basically. Mm-hmm. They are shorter, yes, but they're very intense. And after a month, you're like, okay, screw this. I'm going back to one training session a day, or like my regular schedule. So yeah. I don't use it with clients. I don't use it with myself. I've done it, but I think it takes a certain kind of person to really like it. I know some people that really love it and they do it long term. But I think if you want to dip your toes into the water and try it, fine. But I would not recommend it long term for most people.
Yeah, I think that's a sound approach to have for sure. And kind of the next thing that I'd like to shift towards is range of motion. So there's also kind of the argument that more range of motion is better, kind of absolute for across exercises. And there's also people that kind of like to use, well, maybe if we went a little bit less range of motion here, but used a little bit more weight, maybe that would be beneficial. So where do you kind of fall on the lines of using more range of motion versus maybe using a little bit more weight?
Yeah. I usually like to bring up the bench press, the barbell bench press, with this topic, because usually people are just crazy about touching the bar to your chest. And when you do not do that, you did not complete the rep, and it's basically cheating and whatever. So what I usually tell people or ask people is this: if you have like twins and everything is completely identical, they are twins, so everything is completely identical except the forearm length. So one of them has longer forearms, and twin number A is lowering the bar to his chest and touches his chest and comes back up, and it's a complete rep, right? The second twin is trying to do the same thing, but like an inch before the bar touches his chest, he just stops. So basically, within his scapular architecture, within his pec mechanics, within his pressing mechanics, and the stimulus he's creating for his pec, everything remains the same. It's the exact same stimulus. He's just not touching the bar to his chest and comes back up. For some people, that's an incomplete rep. He did zero reps. So, but they're both growing their pecs to the same degree. So this is a question I ask people. So why would the second twin have to do the same range of motion, perform the same range of motion as the first one, if they have like differing forearm lengths? And this is something people do not consider when they look at range of motion. They just look, they have a certain, it's almost like they have a library in their head of what an exercise is supposed to look like, which is fine for most exercises. But you have to look at individual differences. And some people are built differently than you are or the person demonstrating that exercise. So usually I would recommend to people to use full range of motion, absolutely. But if that means, like for example, with the bench press, that the lower part of the range of motion is only loading like your front delts and your triceps instead of your pecs, then I would recommend to cut short the range of motion and only use a range of motion that loads the target muscle. Because you can load that lower, the bottom third of that movement with a different exercise, a cable fly, whatever it may be, and go into a deep stretch there instead of like taxing the auxiliary muscle groups with the bench press, your front delts, your triceps, and you're not really training the target muscle group if you are approaching it like that. So full range of motion, yes, absolutely, if you're really targeting the main muscle groups that we want to hit.
Gotcha. So basically, look for full range of motion, but for the specific muscle group that you're trying to train. Like, I know one example would be like, well, what do you call full range of motion on lat pull downs? Like, technically, you could pull it down and then keep going and turn it into a press down. Like, but that doesn't make a lot of sense for your lats, you know? So I think that makes a lot of sense there.
Absolutely. I mean, you just mentioned the pull down, the chin up or the pull up is another example. You see a lot of people pull up, and once they cannot maintain like a sternum up position, a chest up position, they cave in and their shoulders roll forward, and they like try to do that to bring their chin up over the bar, which is fine. Right. But they think about the pull up, the chin up as an exercise where you have to get the chin over the bar. Some people should do that because they can anatomically, and some people cannot. They should not do it. They both will train their lats, the upper back, and so on and so forth, and create a stimulus, but one of them will have shoulder pain because he thinks he has to go full range of motion when he's not made for that.
Right, for sure. I think that makes a lot of sense. And I think something similar could be said on an exercise like a squat. Like, some people are just built really well to squat, whereas others, it's like, man, if this person can get to parallel, they're probably doing a heck of a job. And I think something that you're quite a fan of is Smith machine squats. Is that right?
Correct,
so would you kind of speak on why you kind of like that exercise and maybe what your thoughts are on that?
Yeah. I mean, it's more than just a cheap replacement for a hack squat. The Smith machine squat allows you to go rock bottom without bothering what's going on with your levers, without bothering how mobile your hip is, how deep or how narrow your hip socket is, stuff like that. So regardless of how you're built and your mobility, you can, most pretty much everybody can go ass to grass or very, very far below parallel with a Smith squat, because obviously it's a guided exercise. So you can just reduce the stability aspect of that exercise compared to free weight squats. And the squat is another perfect example where people like tell others that they have not completed a rep when they do not go to ass to grass. And if we're looking at a power lifter, he has to squat a certain depth. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. If we're looking at a weightlifter, he has to squat to a certain depth to catch the barbell. Absolutely. Yep. But as a bodybuilder or somebody interested in hypertrophy, we do not have to do that. If you can do it, I would definitely recommend it. If you're built for it, definitely do it. But if you are not built for it, and there's a ton of people that are not built for it, there's, for example, if you're looking at weightlifters, there's a ton of Asian Chinese weightlifters. There's not a whole lot of weightlifters from Scotland, right? So there's a reason for that, because their hip sockets look vastly different than hip sockets from Asia. And they can do all the mobility stuff in the world. They will never squat like a Chinese weightlifter. So we have to look at these individual differences. And once we look at the squat pattern itself, we just have to understand that if we want to stress the quadriceps muscles, the muscles on the front of your leg, we can do that with different exercises, and the squat is one of them. And that does not mean we have to go ass to grass every single rep.
For sure. And I think it's probably a good idea to think about, okay, what muscle group are we trying to stress, rather than, okay, what exercise do I have to do? Because if you think about it in terms of what muscle group do I have to stress, then it kind of opens up the book to, okay, I can use different exercises. And that doesn't necessarily mean that certain exercises might not be a little bit more overloading or a little bit more stressful, but we have all these multiple tools as people interested in developing our physiques or being bodybuilders and things like that.
Absolutely. Another thing that comes to mind with the squat, with the free weight squat, is that it is very easy that your hips escape to the back. So you maybe go down with a very fairly upright upper body position, and you are able to maintain the position. But once you try to come back up and initiate the concentric phase of the lift, the hips shoot all the way back and up. So it turns into pretty much a good morning. And this is why I like to use a whole lot of hack squats or Smith squats for people that are not built to squat, because it's much harder to do that. With a hack squat, your hips are basically locked in. You cannot escape to the back. All the tension has to land in your quads, in your legs. And there's not a whole lot of tension ending up in your lower back. Same with Smith squats. You can still escape to the back with your hips, but you are fairly guided, and you can control much better how you go down, maintain the position, and then explode up with the strength of your quads.
Yep, I really like those two examples for sure. And even on the Smith squats, since it's kind of in that like directed bar path, it's almost like I don't have to think about stabilization, anything like that. I can just kind of get after it for that set rather than thinking about some of these other things on squats too.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, what's also funny is the people that are very, very anal about free weight squatting and squatting as to grass, they always stand to the side and look at a perfectly vertical bar path, right? Mm-hmm. They're saying, oh, your bar path is perfectly vertical. That's beautiful. And but then they, again, are the people that say like, oh my God, you're doing Smith squats. That's bad for your back. Well, it's a perfectly vertical bar path in a Smith squat. So it's actually everything you're looking for in a free weight squat. Right. So yeah.
Comes off a little hypocritical for sure.
Absolutely. Yes.
For sure. Cool. Well, I think we covered that pretty well. And then the next thing I'd like to kind of discuss is in your own training, you've kind of, at least what I think anyways, is that you've decided to do favor on the side of doing a little bit more volume, but leaving a little bit more reps in the tank. So would you kind of discuss why you've kind of come to that decision to make in your own training?
Yeah. So first of all, I want to give you some insight on my training history and how I've gotten to this point, because I'm not particularly a fan of doing that much more volume and keeping more reps in reserve. I just like lower volume training sessions and lifting mm-hmm. very heavy and to failure. But right now, that is not the right approach for me to make continued progress. So when I started out training, I immediately jumped into dog crap training. And if some of you are maybe familiar with dog crap training, it's a high frequency program. It's not really for a beginner. So the creator, Dan Trudell, like prescribes 3 years minimum of training experience. And I had 3 months and I said, okay, that's fine. Let's do this. So yeah, so that was not the best decision, but I still made tremendous gains because I was a beginner. So right. Whatever you do, as long as you're training, you're going to make gains. Mm-hmm. But then again, I fell in love with that approach. I really like training to failure. I learned it right from the get-go. I knew how to train to failure and really reach true training failure. Yep. And that was a lot of fun to me. And it was very hard for me to get away from that. And a few years later, I learned about rate of perceived exertion. I learned about reps in reserve. I learned about what proximity to failure means and all these things, mm-hmm. all these different training tools that allow you to intelligently structure your training. And I had to like really learn a new approach to training, because to me, every single set used to be to failure. And now I can like, I have to generate more training volume. My volume load had to go up to make progress. So I had to hold myself back for a certain number of sets and bring the effort down that I put into a set, because otherwise I would just train myself into the ground and not really make any continued progress. And now I'm at the point when I started working with Cliff Wilson, who did my training at the beginning of the year. He had me do the highest training volumes I've ever done. And I made absolutely tremendous progress from starting February until now. And I've never done so many sets in a session. Like, we're talking 30 set leg sessions, stuff like that. And I made tremendous progress, but I had to learn to measure my proximity to failure much, much better, because you cannot take 30 sets to failure. I don't care how hardcore you are. You're not going to do like 4 sets of deadlifts, 4 sets of squats, 4 sets of leg extensions, all that to failure. It's not going to happen. And you're not going to do that every single week. So in order for me to continue to make progress, I have to do more volume, basically. Yes. Mm-hmm. And that also means that I have to keep my reps in reserve a bit higher to allow recovery, because I am really good at driving myself into the ground. I've learned that very early on. And now combined with the higher training volumes, that's a bad combination. I'm really good at going to failure and now I'm doing high volume. Nope, that's not going to work. So right. I have to bump up the reps in reserve to be able to withstand that kind of training volume, which is required by now to make progress.
Right. So basically you kind of do it in a way to manage fatigue a little bit, to make sure that you can still accumulate the volume that you need to progress in your training, but not so much to where you're just burying yourself after one single session then.
Absolutely. And you still have to, I mean, I take all of this very serious, but the mm-hmm. fun factor has to still be there. If you go into training and you absolutely hate it, you're not going to be very successful with, mm-hmm. with that training approach. So I have to find a good middle ground of like, okay, pushing hard sets hard enough and also doing enough volume that allows me to make continued progress. And that middle ground is not always easy to find, but I'm doing my best. And I think that is something that is also a challenge for an advanced trainee to make good calls with his own training to find that path.
Right, for sure. And as kind of a more advanced trainee, I know you've kind of talked about taking a little bit more of a by feel approach. So would you kind of discuss what you kind of do to maybe auto-regulate your training kind of by feel or by your own intuition, and who you might recommend to take a more by feel approach and who it might not be better for?
Yeah, I think with somebody who's really advanced, I've been training for 10 years now. I've basically played sports all my life, and then I found bodybuilding, and ever since then I basically started out with a training program and stuck to a training program, different training programs, for the last 10 years. And nowadays I still have a rough plan when I go into the gym. I still know what exercises to do, but I'm not completely set on the rep range for every single exercise. I'm not completely set on the amount of sets. I might use a different progression scheme this training session. So I might do my top set first and then do a few back off sets, or I might pyramid up to my heaviest set. It's a little bit different every single training session. But, and this is very important, I still log every training session. I would absolutely recommend that to everybody, no matter if you're beginner, intermediate, or advanced. I would log my training all the time. It's super important. I can go back to every single training session of the last 10 years. And I think that is really important, because you can spot patterns and you can see what allows you to work the hardest and what works best for you. You find different exercises that you really like. You find out about training volumes, about volume landmarks, if you want to say, and what works best for you and how much volume certain muscle groups can tolerate. So you can only find that out if you have a training log. And the whole by feel thing is definitely not something for a beginner, not something for an intermediate, because you will feel something is hard and you want to quit. And that's certainly not the way to make progress. So as a beginner, you want to learn the lifts. You want to understand how the mechanics of each lift works. You want to get a feel for the lifts, but not so much a feel of what you perceive, because at the beginning everything is going to be hard, right? You just want to, you're basically doing your first deadlift, your first squat, and it's relatively heavy and you just want to quit. So you have to stick with that. So I by now know what is really heavy, plus I have the numbers to go with it. I know if there's like 500 pounds on a bar, that should feel like that, or that should feel like that. So I have like so much experience to go with it that I know that if it feels like that, that means that. So a beginner cannot do that. He does not have the training experience. He doesn't have the numbers to go with it. And he just simply does not understand what's going on here. So the whole by feel thing, I see a lot of people nowadays with super detailed periodized training programs. And I think that's great. They have their spreadsheets and everything is planned out in advance. I personally don't do that. But I think that sometimes you can make really good calls within the training session and auto regulate like that as an advanced trainee. And maybe sticking to the plan as it is laid out is not always the best idea. Maybe you get injured if you're like sticking to the plan as it is written out. I know for myself, if I get coached by somebody else and they give me a certain training program, I will stick to it every set, every rep, everything is going to be on point. And more often than not, that has not been the best approach, because I've already been fatigued mid-session and I still continue training, and it wasn't the smartest decision. Maybe you're getting overuse injuries, you're like injuring yourself in a serious way or stuff like that. So with the whole by feel approach, I'm not saying that you should only do stuff that feels good. You should do the hard stuff. You should work hard. You should do rows instead of pull downs. But at the same time, you should understand what you're dealing with and what signals your body is giving you.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And is there like any particular indicators during your session that you're kind of looking for, like, okay, hey, if I notice this, then I might make this change in my session? Is there anything like that, or is it basically really just an intuitive feeling that you have, man, maybe this wouldn't be a good call to do this?
That's a really good question, and I actually haven't thought about that. What indicator is making me make changes, basically? Mm-hmm. One thing I can definitely say that something like mind-muscle connection and how a repetition feels and how a contraction feels plays a large part, especially with isolation exercises. I would not be too focused on mind-muscle connection with a squat or deadlift. Mm-hmm. It's more about external cues with those lifts. But with an isolation exercise, I really want to focus how high is the quality of that contraction. And then if the quality is not where I want it to be, I just go, for example, to a different leg extension machine. I go to a different leg curl and perform it there. It really doesn't matter a whole lot if I progress on this specific leg curl machine. It's a leg curl, right? It's not an RDL. It's not a squat. It's not a deadlift. It really doesn't matter a whole lot. So as long as I log that other machine and I know what numbers I'm pushing there, everything is going to be fine. I can just compare later, and maybe next time I go to the second machine or the other time I go to the other machine. So it really doesn't matter. But usually with isolation exercises, it's the quality of the contraction. And with the bigger exercises, if something hurts, if something is not feeling right, if the movement doesn't feel smooth, I might change the progression scheme. I might ramp up to a heavier set and see if I do a few more warm-up sets, if it starts to feel better. And if it doesn't, I would just stop doing the exercise. That took me a long time to actually do that, because there's so much ego involved with what we are doing here, and you want to push hard and you want to work hard and all that good stuff, but it doesn't really help you if you're injured. So if you are injured, you cannot train, and I want to train. I can only get better if I train. So that is something that I've learned in like the last 2 years, and especially with my last contest prep, to like take what is there on that particular day. And if it isn't there, there's nothing, it's fine. Just go home. That's basically it.
And I totally agree that that is something that is difficult in practice as well, because it is a largely ego thing, to where we want to get in there. We want to just crush it on certain sets, and we want to shoot for PRs, and we don't want to accept the fact that on that particular day, we might not be at our best. So I definitely think that is something that is definitely a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, it's very hard to figure out if you're just trying to avoid the hard work, or if there's actually something wrong. That is the biggest challenge. If you can figure that out, you're gonna be leaps and bounds ahead of the other people. It should not. Audio regulation should not be a tool to work less hard.
Right.
It should be a tool to avoid injury, to avoid making bad decisions in your training. That should be the goal of audio regulation, and listening to your body and going by feel. So that's the goal. The goal is not to work hard, less hard.
Right. And I think it would be really easy to tell ourselves this story why we should work less hard on this certain thing, because, you know, we like the path of least resistance. So I think it was definitely tough with this kind of auto-regulating to play the balance of, should I really back off a little bit here, or am I just kind of telling myself this story to work a little bit easier?
Yeah, you have to be really careful there, because your body actually doesn't want to do that. Your body is saying, right, hey, let's save some energy here and prepare for the upcoming winter, basically, and cheat as many reps as possible. So swing the weight around and use momentum and stuff like that, instead of using it when it's appropriate, so we can save energy. So you really have to be very careful with this whole by feel thing. So I just want to warn people, and so not later on somebody is approaching me and telling me, you want to make it easier for anybody. It's not the goal. The goal is to be smart with your decisions in the gym when you make adjustments on the fly.
Yep, totally. And I think that covers the training aspect of things pretty well. And the kind of the next thing I'd like to shift to is kind of your off-season approach to more nutrition, or it doesn't necessarily have to be your off-season, but I'm kind of interested in what you kind of like for rates of weight gain throughout like a more off-season phase for maybe not like a super advanced bodybuilder, but maybe more so intermediate, later intermediate individual, somewhere in there.
Sure, man. I would say, I mean, there's some percentages out there. There's some gain rates, gain rate recommendations in pounds out there. I know there's some of El Naragon and Eric Helms and those guys. Mm-hmm. And I think those are great. I think you could like break it down regardless of your training experience and training level to something very, very simple. The slowest rate of gain possible while still making progress in your training. I would say that sums it up pretty well, regardless what your training level is. For a beginner, that's going to be much, much faster, obviously, than for an advanced trainee. With somebody who's advanced, your focus should basically be on recovery and your performance in the gym. There will be months and weeks where you will not see a difference on the scale. And that is totally fine. Nothing in nature is linear. So very often you will like maintain the same weight for 2 months. You're still in a surplus. And then all of a sudden your weight jumps up by like half a pound or a pound and you maintain that. And that's actually totally fine. You do not have to gain like a pound or 2 pounds every single week, because once you've built a certain amount of muscle, you are more likely to gain a whole lot of fat with those gain rates. Right. But for somebody who's a beginner, 2 pounds, oh, a pound to 2 pounds a week is perfectly fine. So I think it really depends on the person. Some people can really push it. And some people are like gaining 60 pounds in their first year, in the first 2 years or 3 years of training. I know some guys like that. They gain like 20 pounds in the first year, 20 pounds in the second year, and they look fine. They're not fat slobs. So they would not have adhered to those very conservative gain rates.
Right.
And if they would have done that, they would not have made as many gains. So you have to be careful with those gain rates. And I think if you're focusing on training performance and using a surplus that is small enough to allow you to progress, then everything is going to be fine. And for everybody, regardless of gain rates or not, I would recommend taking check-in pictures with yourself, like take regular pictures of yourself weekly or monthly to see if they correlate with your training performance. If you're getting stronger and you're looking better and bulkier in your check-in pictures with yourself, then something is going right. If that is not the case, it's just another way of measuring progress. And I mean, gain rates are fine and well, but I think some people assume that if they gain at a certain amount of rate, that's it. I'm fine. I cannot do more. But maybe you could do more, or maybe you're going too fast. So focus on your training performance, basically.
I really like that. So basically, it's like, all right, let's with our calories at least, let's put us probably into some sort of calorie surplus. And then after we're in some sort of surplus, then let's focus on really trying to improve our training performance and really focusing on that stimulus to grow the muscles. That sound about right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Cool. You do not have to make crazy adjustments every week.
Cool. Because I know there's points in my training to where I was like, okay, if I'm gaining 2 pounds a month, then it was almost like I'm just going to put on muscle rather than really thinking about my training and that training stimulus.
Yeah. I mean, growing muscle is a long-term project, and the best way is to just go into the smallest possible surplus, stay there, and train your ass off. And then a couple months later, see what happens. That's it, basically.
For sure. And, you know, some people notice that when they kind of hang out at a heavier body weight in the off season or after gaining some certain weight, it tends to harden up a little bit, or it tends to look a little bit better. So have you found that in your experience gaining some weight, kind of just maintaining that weight for a while and having it look a little bit better?
Oh, absolutely. I'm currently experiencing that, and I've had basically the last deficit, calorie deficit I've been in was my contest prep last year. So I've been in a surplus for 1.5 years now. Jeez. And that's the longest basically before bodybuilding or after after getting into bodybuilding, where I've been in a continued calorie surplus. And it has served me very well. And I think one of the biggest mistakes, especially with smaller guys that don't have a whole lot of muscle, is they put on a little bit of muscle and a little bit of extra fat, and they immediately do a mini cut. And you're basically cutting away some of the muscle you've just built. So people like that just have to understand and learn to appreciate what it takes to build a lot of muscle long term. And that means hanging out in a surplus for longer periods of time, and not just 3 months or 4 months. Maybe it's a year, maybe it's 2 years. Mm-hmm. So, and when you hang out at that body weight, your body will try to find homeostasis again and will try to find like a new setting point with that body weight. And it's very possible that you get leaner while maintaining the body weight. So there's some recomp going on, especially with beginners.
Yeah. And especially if you consider these heavier body weights, your performance might be a little bit higher. So maybe your performance is higher, so you can use that in the gym. And then there's a little bit more of a stimulus to kind of grow some muscle. So then you can kind of get a little bit of that muscle growth effect or that recomp while you're at that body weight as well.
Absolutely. And if we think how long it takes to build muscle and how easy it is to burn fat, I mean, how much muscle can you build in 12 weeks? Not a whole lot. How much fat can you burn in 12 weeks? Like if you want to go really aggressive, you can like burn 12 pounds of fat. It's super, it's not out of the ordinary. There's no way you're building 12 pounds of muscle in 12 weeks. So if we approach it like that and look at it like that, we should spend more time in a surplus and less cutting down all the time because we want to look a certain way.
Yep, totally. I'm totally on board with that. And kind of the last thing I'd like to touch on is, have you ever played with like a relatively higher protein diet? Because I know there's some people that will say, okay, all you need is like 1.6 grams per kg. And then there's also a little bit of research that higher protein intakes might be beneficial. So do you have any anecdotal evidence or experience with playing out with higher protein intakes or anything like that?
Yeah, I do. And I'm a big proponent of higher protein intakes. I hope the research catches up in like the next 5 to 10 years, because there's some research out there. I mean, there's the Jose Antonio studies out there with the higher protein intakes. And I like those, but we need a lot more. And I think the biggest problem with the study designs is the length of the studies. I think it doesn't really give credit to the higher protein intakes when you do a study of like 12 weeks. So I would be interested in a study of like 12 months. So that's going to be very expensive and nobody's going to fund that. But yeah, I would like to see that, because I see a huge positive difference with clients and myself when I have higher protein intakes. So I would say we're in the range of 2 grams per pound. And that is obviously very high. And what I noticed right away, within like a week, people just feel fuller, but they also look fuller. Their muscles look fuller. Mm. And another thing, which is not something you would expect from higher protein, is their performance goes up. And it's not due to like increased carbohydrates. Everything remains the same. It's just the protein increases. So I think we are onto something. And this is something I've adopted very early on with my training. I immediately jumped into higher protein amounts because I read forums from enhanced people. And I thought, well, they are taking in huge amounts of protein. I have to do the same thing.
Right.
And so it was actually new to me when I like got more into the evidence-based realm and read about 1 gram per pound. I was like, this is nothing. Like, this is 2 meals. And so then I got back when I started working with Cliff Wilson again. He is also a proponent of higher protein intakes, and he does it with all his clients, with all his competitors. Mm-hmm. And he's seeing tremendous results as well. So I think we are onto something, and I just hope there's more and more research coming out looking at like 2 to maybe even 3 grams per pound of protein a day.
Yeah, I think that's definitely something that's coming down the chute here. You know, with the literature, it's always going to be trying to play catch up. So I think it's definitely really interesting to see some of Antonio's work of those really higher protein intakes. And do you still just kind of spread those all out across 4 to 6 meals throughout the day? Or is that kind of your approach to protein spread?
Yeah, absolutely. It's pretty much evenly distributed across the day. I do 4 meals a day, and I have a whey isolate shake intra workout because my sessions are really long. Yeah. And so I basically have to do that to get a small meal in with my training, and
basically
also helps with recovery a bit. But it's mainly because it's a time issue. If you're like 4 hours in the gym, you're like missing a meal. So I just have a liquid meal instead, and that's basically all that is to it. But yeah, and with those higher protein amounts, you're just getting used to eating really large portion sizes of like egg whites, of Greek yogurt, of beef and stuff like that. But it's, every time a new client signs up with me, they're like, in the first 2 weeks, they're like, oh my God, this is so much protein. But after those 2 weeks, they really get accustomed to the amounts, and it's not a big deal anymore. Like going back and eating like a 4 ounce steak, I'm like, what is this? This is nothing. So you just get used to different amounts, and it's not that bad when it comes to fullness and satiating you. So you just get used to it.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that is about all the time we have today. Where can people kind of connect with you or find you online and stuff like that?
Basically on my website, which is just my name, valentintambosi.com, and my Instagram, which is basically just my name.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for coming on today. I really do appreciate it.
Thanks, man. Thank you so much for having me.
Make sure to screenshot this, put it on your story, go check out Valentine's stuff, go check out my stuff for coaching and things like that at ryanjsalomon.com. Thanks for listening, and I will see you in that next episode.